Welcome to my next lecture series. So we were looking into module 6. I have already presented you two lectures on thread creation syntax and thread architectures. So in today's lecture we will be looking into how synchronization mechanism is implemented in different programming languages. So synchronization, as I told you earlier, it is a way by which the thread's execution will be controlled. Okay, so it can this synchronization can either make operation atomic or delay the operation until some condition holds. Okay, so synchronization can be achieved by either making the operations atomic, that is to complete one set of operations together without any preemption, or delay a particular operation until some precondition holds. So this atomicity is achieved with the help of mutual exclusion. So for this, mutual exclusive locks are used, and the purpose of these locks are to ensure that only one thread executes the critical region. A critical region is the shared code which will be accessed by different threads. So mutual exclusive locks, they will ensure that only one thread is active at the critical region. And conditional synchronization, that is the second category, delaying the operation until some condition holds. So conditional synchronization, it allows a thread to wait for that condition to happen in one or more shared variables. Okay, so for atomicity's sake, mutual exclusive locks are used, and for conditional synchronization, the thread has to wait until that condition is satisfied. So first category of synchronization is called as busy wait synchronization. Under this, we will be looking into two categories. One is the mutual exclusive locks and the other one is the barrier. So these two concepts together we call it as the approach for busy wait synchronization. So busy wait synchronization, or just spinning, is a technique in which a process repeatedly checks to see if a condition is true. If the condition is true, the process can enter the critical region, or else it still keeps on spinning until the condition is true so that it gets a chance to enter the critical section. So spin locks, so this spin lock, that is mutual exclusive lock, so this is a lock which causes a thread which is waiting to enter the critical section to repeatedly check if the lock is available. So the critical region will be protected by a lock. Okay, so any thread or any process which is trying to access that critical region will repeatedly check this lock if it is free or occupied. If it is free, then the particular thread can acquire the lock and enter the critical region so that no other threads will enter that critical region. If it is not free, the thread has to repeatedly check the lock to see if it is free. When it is free, it can enter. So this continuous checking of the lock is called as spinning. So the method is called as spin lock. So this spin lock is implemented by means of the instruction called test and set. It's a short form TSL, test and set locks. So this test and set lock, it sets a boolean variable to true and returns an indication of whether the variable was previously false or not. That is, two operations will be done together as one single atomic operation. So it will first set value 1 to the location, memory location, and it will return the previous value of that lock to the particular column. Okay, so test and set. So it will first set the particular set the value 1 of the 1 to the lock for which it is waiting, and then it will just get the previous value of that lock. So TSL instruction, or test and set instruction, as I told you, it is used to write 1, that is set to memory location, and return the old value of the lock. And these two together will be done as a single atomic operation. Okay, so the if the old value of the lock which was returned, if it was 0, then the thread can acquire it, set it to 1 and enter the critical region. Otherwise, it spins, that is, it will repeatedly check till the lock is free. So, a small pseudocode will be written like, while not test and set off this lock, okay. If it is not test and set off this lock, then spin. If it is test and set, then you can proceed entering the critical region. Now, what is the disadvantage with this method? Okay. Now, imagine that I have two processor, P1 and P2. Okay. Now, processor P1 has obtained a lock, okay, and P2 is waiting for the lock. Okay, process P1 has obtained the lock and P2 is waiting for the lock. Okay. So, what happens is P2 will keep on testing to acquire the lock, whether the lock is free or not, to acquire the lock. So, this testing will require a lot of bus transactions, right? So, when a processor has obtained a lock, all other processors, suppose if P1 has released and P2 has obtained, is going to obtain the lock, okay? So, when P1 has released the lock, all other processors which also wish to obtain the same lock, it keeps trying to obtain the lock by initiating bus transactions. So, imagine that P1 is already inside the critical region and it is protected by a lock. There are some P2 to P7 processors which are ready to acquire that lock. Now, what happens when P1 is about to release? All these P2 to P7 processes is continuously testing the lock to check if it is free or not. And this incurs lot of bus transactions. So, this increases the bus traffic requirement and as a result, it slows all other traffic from the cache and as a result, it appears to be coherence misses. So, this is a disadvantage with TSL approach, test and set locks. So, a slight improvement to this particular method is called as test and set. Okay, test and set instruction. So, that is an improvement over this TSL. And what this method will do is, it does not initiate lock acquisition requests continuously. So, we will see what it is. Okay, so this test and set instruction, it spins with ordinary reads until the lock is free. So, here you can see the pseudocode of that. You have a lock which is initially set false. I have a method called acquire lock with a lock reference is being provided. It will test if, that is while not test and set. Okay, while not test and set. Then again what I am doing, while L. Okay, so this test and set instruction is just to see if the lock is free or not. That is, it will set the value 1 and read the value of the previous value of the lock. Only for that purpose we are checking this test and set. And for spinning sake we are using this value of L. So, while L, until L is 1 you will just spin. When L is 0 you can enter. So, in the previous method we were just each and every time, each and every process has to test and then it has to set and then test, set and test. So, it will loop with this particular approach. So, each time onto memory you are writing and testing. That is why cache coherence problem occurs. But in this case, you are using this instruction only once and you are spinning on this particular lock. So, it is simply reading the lock and not going to write anything onto the memory. So, this is an improvement of the basic test and set lock. And this is the procedure release which will actually release the lock. Okay. So, that is the difference between test and set instruction. Another approach which is implemented by larger machines is using back off. Okay. So, these two instructions, as it incurs lot of traffic, okay, contention, lot of memory contention, traffic, everything can result. Another method which is used by larger machines is called as back off. So, once a thread has tried to access that lock and it has failed, okay, then what happens? this thread will be given another chance only after a certain period of time. Okay, so by this approach, the number of threads contempting to acquire that lock will be reduced to some extent, and this method is called as backoff. Okay, so once a thread has tried for acquiring the lock and it has failed, immediately it cannot test. It has to wait a certain period of time, after which it can again test. So that time period, other threads can be given chances. So by this process, it reduces the number of threads competing to that critical, to that lock at the same time. So this process is called as backoff. The second approach of busy synchronization is through barriers. So barriers, normal English, we all know that they are, they are some checkpoint like something. Okay. So similarly, here also in this synchronization also, barrier is a checkpoint wherein it allows a group of threads to arrive at that checkpoint. Only if some group of threads arrive at that checkpoint, it will allow the threads to proceed further. So a barrier for a group of threads means that any thread must stop at this point and cannot proceed until all other threads reach this barrier. And this concept is implemented using a shared counter, which can be modified using the fetch and decrement instruction. Okay, so barriers are implemented using a shared counter, which can be modified using the fetch and decrement instruction. So this counter will be initially set at n. N means the number of threads which will be grouped together. Now, as each thread reaches the barrier, counter will be decremented. When the counter becomes zero, it allows all the threads to proceed through the barrier. Okay. So this is a pseudocode for that. You can see I have a shared count variable, which is an integer set to n. Another shared sense variable, which is a boolean, initial value is true. Now for each thread, per thread, a private local variable, local sense variable is assigned, which is of boolean, initial value is true. So this local sense will be private to each thread. The procedure, barrier, central barrier. So I am using this local sense as not local sense. Okay, that is toggling the value. So if it was true, it will become false. It was false, it will become true. Okay. Then I am using this fetch and decrement instruction to check the count. Okay. Each time it will decrement the count and will fetch the count and it will decrement it. Now I am checking if this value is 1. If it is 1, it means that it is the last thread which is arriving at the barrier. Now if it is the last thread, then I have to reinitialize the count to n again, and the sense value, sense is common to this, this will be made with the last local sense value. Otherwise, if this is not the last thread, what I have to do is repeat spinning. That is, that thread has to wait until all other threads has come. And this process will be repeated until this sense becomes the value of local sense. This local sense will be set at this point. Okay. Now imagine that I have three processes, P1, P2 and P3. Now P1 has obtained this. Okay. Now my n value will be 3. Okay. My local sense will be, first initially it was true, so it will be false for P1. Now it will check, it will decrement the value. So n will become 2, count will become 2. So since it is not 1, it will go here, repeat until what? Sense equal to local sense. Now my sense is true and local sense is false. So since they are not equal, it will again come here. Okay. Now again what happens? Local sense will be toggled. Now it was false, it becomes true. Okay. Becomes true. Now what happens? Fetch and decrement. Fetch and decrement, it will check. Fetch and decrement, it will check. Now fetch and decrement has reduced this to 1. Okay, it will decrement to 1, and now it will check if it is the decrement to 1. Now it is the last thread. No, it was the second thread, so it will repeat it until Here also it is not true. So again it will come here for the third thread. What it does is fetch and decrement. Now it becomes, when it becomes 1, so that will be the last thread. Count value will be initialized to next value, n value, which is 3. Now locant sense will be true here, which will be associated with sense. Now when I come here, else part will not be there. Repeat spinning until sense equal to local sense. Now my sense is true and local sense is true, so it will come out of the loop. So this is how barriers work, and these two mechanisms together we use for busy weight synchronization. This is the explanation for that barrier implementation. Next category of synchronization algorithms is called as non-blocking algorithms. So they won't block any process, they are called as non-blocking algorithms. Okay, so here when a lock is acquired by a thread, okay, no other thread can execute it until the lock is released. For example, if I give x equal to foo of x, here we have two actions. First is to read the value of x and the second one is to write the value of x. And this can be, entire operation can be protected by a lock like this. Acquire L, R1, register R1 is having the value of X. Read the value of X and store it in R1. Now another register R2 is used, which will be passing this value of R1 to foo, and whatever will be returned is stored in R2. Now X is associated with value of R2. After doing this, release the lock. Same can be achieved without using a lock using compare and swap instruction. So far we have used lock to perform things. Now without using locks also you can perform synchronization. So one such instruction is called as compare and swap instruction. So it is written as CAS, and this instruction, it takes three arguments: memory location where value is to be replaced, old value read, and new value to be written. So these three arguments will be given to this CAS instruction. Okay, so we will see the same code written using CAS. So X is read and stored in R1. Foo is called with R1. Result is stored in R2. Now instead of lock, I have not used any lock here. I am calling this CAS with three arguments. First is the location where value is to be replaced. We have to write to X. So X we are giving here. Second is the value, old value of X being read, which is R1. Next is the new value to be written, which is R2. Now this instruction will check if the value of X and R1 are same. If they are same, then R2, value of R2 will be written onto X. Otherwise, it will not be written. And if it is successful, it will be returning true. Otherwise, it will return false. So if not R2, if this is not successful, then go to start and repeat again. Otherwise, you can end it up. So without using locks, using a hardware instruction, compare and swap, the lock approach is possible. So it will not block any threads from its working. So the generalized CAS statement will be like this. Repeat. So prepare CAS until success, then clean up. So prepare part, what it will do is it will read the old value of the variable which we are going to protect it, okay, and what the new value should be written onto that. Now clean up is empty, that is clean up will be clean up. If you want, you can do any clean up actions. If you want, it can be given. So performing cleanup for another thread's operation is called as helping. Okay, performing cleanup for another thread's operation is called as helping. Okay, now this is the scheduler implementation. Okay, of non-blocking algorithms. So I'll be explaining this. So I have a scheduler lock. Okay, a low-level lock. Okay, then a ready list queue of thread and per process private current thread. Okay, for each and every process you have a private current thread. Now This is the procedure for reschedule. This is the procedure for transfer. Okay. Okay, we will start with yield and sleep on. So, what is the difference between yield and sleep on? I have explained in the previous slide. Okay. So, one is voluntarily giving control to another thread. The other one is scheduler automatically gives control to another thread. Okay. So, when you are calling the yield procedure, okay. So, first thing is to disable the time signals. Then it will call the acquire lock. Okay. And the lock reference will be given so that this process can acquire the lock. And what it should do is, it is going to yield its control to some other, that is, it is going to yield its processor to some other thread. So it is by willingly it is giving, so it has to, but this thread has not yet completed, so it will enqueue the current thread onto ready list. That is, in future it has to work again, so it will enqueue the current thread onto ready list, and then it will call the reschedule. So when it calls the reschedule, it will come to the rescheduling algorithm. Okay, here scheduler lock is already held by the current process and timer signals are disabled. Okay, a thread of control is created. Now it will dequeue from the ready list. So from the ready list, the next thread will be dequeued. Okay, and if it is null, exit. If there is no thread waiting, exit. If a thread is waiting, okay, what it should do is, so it has to release the lock so that that thread can acquire the lock. So this current thread will release the lock. Okay, then the same lock will be acquired by the other thread, which is dequeued. Okay, and then transfer control to that thread T. Okay, now this thread will release all the control. After transferring the control, that thread will start working, and then it will come back after rescheduling. It will come back, release lock and re-enable signals. So that thread will acquire the processor and it starts executing. So same process with sleep on also. If it is blocked for some purpose, but for sleep on, instead of ready list, it is not voluntarily doing so, another queue of thread will be created where it will be enqueued. Okay. So assume that caller has already disabled signals, acquired scheduler lock will reverse these actions when we return. So enqueue current thread onto queue, okay, and reschedule because it is blocked. It is not ready to run. It is blocked, okay. So due to until some condition is satisfied. So for that condition to satisfy, it has actually wait. So when it calls reschedule, the same things happens with reschedule. Okay. So this is how scheduler implementation happens. Pseudocode for scheduler implementation. Okay, busy wait scheduler implementation. Now, what is the problem with this busy wait synchronization is that it consumes lots of processor cycles. Okay, so that is the main disadvantage with busy wait synchronization. So that can actually hinder the performance of the system. So to overcome that, another approach used is scheduler based synchronization mechanisms. So to overcome the disadvantage of busy wait synchronization, we go for scheduler based synchronization mechanisms. So switch to a different thread when the one that was running blocks. That is the concept used here. This is the algorithm used for that. This is our normal algorithm. Only thing is that a timeout period will be set. So till that timeout period only, and this timeout period will be decremented each and every time. So till that timeout period only, a lock can be given to a for a particular process. After that timeout period, lock will be released, automatically released from that process, and it will be given to some other process. Just like round robin scheduling, time slice will be allocated. So here the time slice is given as timeout, which is set onto a counter variable, and this counter variable will be decremented each and every time, when it becomes 0, OS will yield, that is processor will be taken from that process and given to some other process. And before that timeout period, if this process has done its work, then the timeout will be, count will be reset to the timeout value and it will release the lock. So this is scheduler based synchronization mechanism, that is not a voluntary process. Okay, now another method of a synchronization is called as semaphores. Okay, so another method is called as semaphore. So semaphores are the oldest method of scheduler based synchronization. Okay, so a thread can make two calls. One is the call to P, which automatically decrements the counter, okay, and then waits until it is non-negative. And another call is to V, which increments the counter and wakes up a waiting thread. Okay. So semaphore whose counter is initialized to 1 and for which P and V operations occur in a matched pair is known as binary semaphore. Okay. So this is normal like a lock. Binary semaphore will be moreover like a lock. So P operation acquires the lock, okay, by decrementing the counter and V releases it. So this is the pseudocode for that. So you have a semaphore which is a record, okay, n some non-negative integer maximum value, q is the q of threads. I have two procedures, P and V. So reference will be given as semaphore. With this semaphore you have to call this P. So as with other methods, disable time signals, acquire the lock. And what I have to do is, I have decrement the value of this n to 1. So P operation will decrement this value, okay. So decrement current value by 1 and it have to check if non-negative. So if s dot n is less than 0, then sleep on Q, okay, sleep. Otherwise, if it is not there and before that you have done the work, release the rock and re-enable signals. Similarly, procedure B, procedure V, again disable signal, acquire lock. This will increment the counter n by 1. If it is less than or equal to 0, whenever it has become less than or equal to 0, that means at least one thread is waiting. So what I have to do is, waiting thread has to be enqueued onto ready list. Okay, so dq from the queue, which was put into wait from the queue, it dequeues and made onto ready list, then release lock and re-enable signals. So this is an example of a bounded buffer problem with semaphores. So I have a buffer, okay, size which is an array of size 1 to some n, okay. Then I have two variables, next full and next empty, which is initialized to 1. I have a mutex which acts as semaphore, initial value 1. Then empty slots, full slots again act as semaphore with values size n and 0 respectively. So the task is to enter and remove values from this array. So this will be done by different threads. So first insert operation, the data to be inserted is D. So for what I have to do is, first the slot will be empty. Okay, empty slot which is n, so that has to be decremented because I am going to enter a item. So number of empty slots should be reduced. So P of empty slot and P of mutex. So mutex has to be 0 because if in this case another process comes and calls remove, it should not work. Okay, because okay, so here also I am calling P of mutex. So this is 0, this is minus 1, so it will wait. Here we have given, if it is less than 0, wait. So it will wait. So that is why P of mutex. Now on to buffer, next empty. Next empty slot, I am entering the value D. And next empty will be incremented by 1. So once value is inserted, till value is inserted, no other process should enter, preempt and enter. So till that time, it is kept as such. Okay, after that, mutex will be incremented, becomes 1, and full slots, number of items in full slots will be incremented, so V of full slots. Similarly, remove, data will be removed. So first full slots has to be decremented. So number of full slot, because I am going to remove a data, so that need to be decremented. Again, mutex has to be acquired, so it has to be decremented. Now from the buffer, okay, so next full item has to be removed and stored in D. Next full will be incremented by 1. I have to increment mutex and increment empty slots, then return the value of D which was taken from the thing. So this is like when the process is going to enter a value into array, if preemption happens and another process comes to remove it, then this mutex will be 0, then it will not be incremented. So using this semaphore, this will be, these two process will be sharedly done by different processes. Okay, so today's lecture we have seen two synchronization mechanisms. One is busy wait synchronization for protecting atomicity, and the other one is conditional synchronization using scheduler based synchronization. So under busy waiting, we have seen two categories. One is test and set locks, normal locks, and the other one is barriers. And under scheduler based synchronization, we saw a timer based synchronization, and another one is the semaphore based synchronization. Now an alternative from these two is the non-blocking algorithm, which is with the help of CAS instruction, the concept of locks can be implemented. So with this I wind up the lecture, and these two questions are asked many times in the university. One is regarding the busy wait synchronization, and the other one is regarding the semaphores. So these two questions have been repeatedly asked in university. So thank you for listening. So I'll be coming up with my next lecture on runtime management. So in the sixth module, we have two parts. One is regarding the threats and all. The other one is regarding runtime management. So threats, we have only three concepts. So that I have covered. The other half, which is runtime management, it has like virtual machines, then debugging, performance analysis, then translation, rewriting, all those things. So that will be covering in the next lectures. So thank you for listening. Thank you.